Thank you, Lord. Oh, come on. We can praise Him more than that, people. We're here to praise the Lord God Almighty. We're here just to sing praises to His name. If we praise Him, He said He will show up and He will heal. He will deliver. He will just change. He will break the chains that bind. He will heal the sick. He said that if we praise Him, His glory will come down. But if we don't praise Him, the very rocks will all cry us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
On your trials, on your pains, on your heartaches. I have overcome the world. Focus on me. Focus on me. I have overcome the world. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
For some reason, he's pointing, go ahead, keep playing, Rick. He's pointing out, for some reason, he's pointing out everybody's opinions out very clearly, and they are different from ours. And he's making us, the enemy is trying to bring division into the church. You know what? There is no such thing as division in the church. There is no such thing as problems in the church. Because you know what? We serve a God of love. Love conquers all. Love conquers all problems. Love conquers all division. Love conquers all calamities. Love conquers everything. He died on the cross. Why? Because He loved us. He loved us. And what is He telling us? Is He's saying, hold on to me. Hold on to me closely. If you will hold on to me closely, I will give you my opinion. And my opinion, if it's everything good with Him, it's good with each other. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah.
To you.
Come to know the weakness that I see.
my people who are called by my name. What did he say? Well, what? That's the word, humbled. He wants to see you humbled before him. And he's not allowing me to go down, to keep going, because there are people here and he's saying they need to come humbled before him. Humbled before him, humbled before the throne. And I can't go on. He said he will heal your land. Hallelujah. All right, Jesus. Okay, he's coming, I don't want to run out of my shoes. He's coming.
sing in this song, the power of love, I felt that the Lord was putting on my heart to read scripture about love. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, starting at verse 4 says, charity, which is love, suffers long. It is kind. We're kind to each other. It envies not, vaunts not itself. It does not brag. It's not puffed up. Does not behave itself unseemingly. Seeks not its own. Is not easily provoked. Thinks no evil. Rejoices not in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Love, it bears all things, believes all things, it hopes all things, endures all things.
Yes.
And love never fails.
That's right. Yeah. Hallelujah.
Said and to draw close to Him, which in turn will help us to draw close to each other. Welcome to Joy and Praise Fellowship. So good to have each and every one of you here. I don't take that for granted. You know, I was just talking to Joey Cruz. I asked him, when is he going away to college? And, oh, his mother's already in panic mode, you know. She's so proud of him one sense, the other sense, oh, my boy's going away. Luckily, he's only an hour and a half away. So Joey said, next Sunday will be his last Sunday for a while until we go off to college. We're proud of you, Joey. And, boy, give him a nice name. And I'm sure that our thoughts and prayers will be with you as you do your studies, and when you make it famous and rich, don't forget about us. At this time, we like to take care of what we call a very important business, that is acknowledging our new visitors. You know, all of our regular attenders and members are very valuable to us. You are what makes Joy and Praise Fellowship. But as always, our new visitors that come in, we want to make feel welcome. We want you as a new visitor to know that we care about you, we're thankful that you're here, and we would love to see more of you if the Lord wills. So if you're a new visitor, can you raise your hand today with us? We got some right over here. We have a card to give you to fill out, and we have a gift for you. Before you leave today, make sure you get a gift. We have a gift in the front for you. We had this, Al, why don't you introduce Al? Al, can you introduce this fine couple for us?
That's my niece, Jennifer, and her husband, Jack. Jack's from the Netherlands.
From the Netherlands.
Wow. They moved out from New York State. They just moved to Florida on Thursday. Oh, wow. Already over here.
Marcus, who's this beautiful lady next to you here?
This beautiful lady is my fiancée. Her name is Maria.
Fiancée Maria. Keep praying for Steve. Not for his physical body. His wife's in France right now, but he's one of our missionaries that we support. And I know it's got to be tough on Steve. So keep Steve in your prayers. Praise God. He's already a sick puppy already, missing his wife. Praise the Lord. At this time, we're going to have two offerings today. Today is our second Sunday of the month. We take up our missionary offering. But we'll take up our first offering, will be our general tithing offerings. And a little while later, we'll take up the missions offering. So at this time, can you bow your heads with me as we take up our first offering, which is our general tithing and offerings above that. Father, in Jesus' name, we give you praise today. God, you offered to us your Son. God, we offer back to you our lives. God, bless this offering. Take it, may it further your kingdom. And as we give to further your kingdom, God, may you further our kingdoms, our homes, our lives. For this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Give as generous as you can to spend. It's very important. We have life group sign-ups out in the foyer. That table you see out in the front represents three separate life groups. And we only have, is it one more service left of life group signups? Or two? One more Sunday. So next Sunday will be the final Sunday. So go ahead and sign up for a group. Not only do you learn about God's word, but you really get to know people in your church, you know? And you really bond some good relationships that way. So please sign up in the front before they're all signed up and going, and be a part of a life group. Also, we do have youth group tonight. I know for some of you parents, you might say, well, it's the first day before school starts again. Listen, one thing I love about our youth group, it only goes to about 7:15. That's very, very early to still get home, get yourself rested up for school tomorrow. Please, let's not make any excuse to come out. Come out tonight to youth group. Let's be a part of a special time. The reason why I have the kids here today is because Devana mentioned to me, she's always Johnny on the spot, she always thinks ahead, that maybe we should just have a prayer over our kids as they start school, whether it be elementary, middle school, or high school, or even college, Joey says. So why don't you come across the front, why don't we have some of the leaders come up and just kind of pray over these kids. Come on up. Yeah, Trinity, you're still in school. If you want to have a blessed year, we won't force you, but if you want to have a blessed year in school, come up and we'll pray for you. Devane, I'm going to have you lead this prayer, okay? Put the microphone out. First thing. Back here. Yeah. Here, leaders, pass your wall down, okay? And, you know, put some on your hand and pass down to the next leader, please.
Right down here.
Lord, your hands and Davina will lead that prayer. If Davina starts to pray for the kids, can you please be a participator? Stretch your hands toward these children. We believe in corporate prayer. We believe in the power of prayer. This is not just the future of Jordan Praise. This is Jordan Praise's presence. And we want to continue to encourage them. I'm so proud of these kids. Okay, Davina, go ahead.
Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Lord God, we know that Satan has a plan to destroy our children.
Yes.
Lord, he has a plan to attack them with sickness, Lord God. Lord Jesus, we just pray right now that your hedge of protection will be around them. Lord God, we are anointing them now, as in the book of James it says, to anoint, Lord God. We're anointing them, Lord God, as your children to go out to the mission field, which is their school grounds, Lord God. That, Lord Jesus, you would give them the right decisions to make. That they will be listening to your Holy Spirit guiding them. Lord God, that no matter what comes at them, Lord Jesus, whether it's temptation, struggles at school, Lord, we rebuke all of that in the name of Jesus. Lord God, that they will be faithful you and to you, and Lord God, that they will not be afraid to share your word with other people, Lord Jesus, just like we learned in BBS. And Lord God, we just, right now, just anoint each and every child. And Lord Jesus, that this hedge of protection will be around them, Lord God. That no evil, Lord God, that is born against them, Lord. No weapon will be prospered, Lord, because you are their Lord, Lord Jesus. And we just pray over each and every child, Lord God, that their health and, Lord Jesus, all the decisions they make, Lord, even in these older students that are going off to high school and to college, they have a lot before them, Lord God, a lot of decisions, a lot of temptation. Lord God, the world that we live in, Lord, everything's just thrown at them and in their face, Lord, of immorality. But, Lord, please let them just listen to your voice and know, Lord Jesus, that they are to make the right decisions according to your word, according to the Bible. And it's in Jesus' mighty name that we pray these things. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Right. Give the Lord a hand clap for that. Hallelujah. Thank you for praying for the kids. The nursery could be dismissed at the time, but we have nursery today. One final announcement is all worship team members and, you know, whether you play an instrument or sing, we have a quick meeting after service today. We won't keep you real long, but please stay back after service today for a quick meeting, all worship team members. At this time, we'd like to you to prepare your hearts for our missions offering. You know the Assemblies of God, that's what we are. We are an Assemblies of God church. That's our denomination here in the religion called Christianity. The Assemblies of God leads the world in missions. We are the greatest missionary organization on the planet. A lot of people don't know that, but we are. Far past the Catholics, far past the Baptists, we are number one in the world. We have missionaries in three quarters of the world right now, and we ourselves sponsor 14 of them every month that we sow into. And I believe that God even wants us to sow more. You know, our local presbyter, that is a pastor that pastors there in the villages, he's over all of our section of AG churches in this area. He told me that when they went into their new building program, he said the Lord told him, invest in missions. Sow into the field, the great commission of God, and I will sow into you. And they said what they did was they took their missions giving and they upped it. And they started supporting more missionaries. And when they did, supernaturally, over the next 6 months to a year, money was flooding into the church in just the craziest of ways. And now they have a wonderful church over there building that they built. So we can never outgive God, and God's heartbeat is world missions, souls around the world. So Father God, in Jesus' name, we pray your blessings upon this offering, this mission offering, God. Your word declares in Matthew 28 that we are to go into all the world and make disciples of all nations. So God, I pray that this offering here this morning may be used to further the mission around the globe, that souls may come to know Jesus Christ. Bless it to your glory, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I want you to keep little glory in your prayers. Rick and Jesse's little daughter, she's running a fever. It's come down some from last night, but still, nonetheless, she must have some type of, you know, infection or something that's caused that fever to come up. And Rick said that she's feeling a little better, but we don't want it to come back again. Let's let it keep going down and stay going in Jesus' name. So keep her in your prayer today as you pray. How many of you know that today is a good day? It is. My friend Luke Bradbury says every day is a good day. Just some days are a little better than others. But every day is a good day. Yes. Alan's in the hospital right now with a bad report from the doctor, but in Jesus, it's still a good day. Because yes. Jesus has got a plan for Alan that he don't even know about yet. Amen. And even in our lives, we may be going through things that to us would maybe deem not such a good thing, but we never know what God's doing. God's got a masterful plan. I continually try to remind myself of that when I'm hit that low moment. Anybody ever hit them low moments? Yes. That moment when you just say, I wish I had somebody in my corner to throw in the towel for me. I'm done. But God said, I got something better for you. Just hang in there. Today I want to share a message that I pray will inspire you. I pray will excite you. I pray will cause you to look at the things of God, the kingdom of God, a little bit differently this morning. Awesome. Are you awesome? God's awesome. So I get to bow your heads with me and we'll pray over this over this message. Preachers are always taking up offerings, right? And we'll see what God would say to us. Father, in Jesus' name, you are indeed awesome. When we see you face to face, Lord, we're going to be so speechless on how awesome you really are. And when you show us a videotape of our lives and all the times that you interceded when we didn't know it, we're going to realize how truly awesome you are. Oh, dear God, we're asking you to be awesome yet again today, to show up in this message, to open up our ears and our hearts and our minds to receive what the Spirit would say here this morning. Give us that special rhema this morning, God. So when we leave this place, God, we really know how awesome you are. For this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Psalm 111, verses 1 through 10 says like this. I will praise the Lord with my whole heart. I'm going to stop there a minute. You know one thing I like about traditionally dominated African-American churches? That when the preacher is speaking, there's a little bit of excitement in the air. Whether it be a drum, whether it be an amen, whether it be a something. Gives us a little bit of a jump start in our step, you know what I'm saying? So I'll start that again. When I praise the Lord with my whole heart.
Amen.
Thank you. Some of you caught the truth. In the assembly of the upright in the congregation, the works of the Lord, he says, are great, studied by all who have pleasure in them. He says, his work is honorable and glorious, and his righteousness endures forever. Amen. He has made his wonderful works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, he says. He has given food to those who fear him. He will ever be mindful of his covenant. He has declared to his people the power of his works and given them the heritage of the nations. The works of his hands are verified and justified. All his precepts are sure. They stand fast forever and ever and are done in truth and uprightness. He has sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Now get this. Holy and awesome is his name.
Amen.
For the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom and a good understanding of all those who do his commandments. For praise of him endures forever.
Amen.
The last four words of verse 9 form the basis of this message. Awesome is his name. The word awesome is used in today's lingo to describe something that is breathtaking, something that is moving, something that is spectacular. Now, when I was a teen, we used the word to describe awesome as fantastic. Since then, there have been many words to use to describe awesome. Words like cool, far out, magnificent, heavy, groovy, And let's not forget J.J. Walker from the TV show Good Times, Dynamite. The word awesome has hung on for some time now. Even a Christian songwriter picked up the phrase and he wrote the song, Our God is an Awesome God. He reigns, he says, from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. How many of you know that God's awesome?
Amen.
He truly is. Awesome is defined as that which inspires reverence and wonder, that which evokes an emotion mingled with respect and fear, that which leaves one temporarily speechless. Now, I've heard some of you say, man, that was an awesome Philly cheesesteak. Or that was an awesome TV show. Or an awesome ball game, or an awesome this, or an awesome that, or an awesome worship set, or an awesome message. But folks, all them and accolades have nothing to compare with the awesomeness of God. Amen. Nothing to compare with God. It leaves you temporarily speechless. What is it that leaves you speechless here this morning? Is it something in nature, like a sunset, or the Grand Canyon, or Niagara Falls? Is it something in the arts, like a painting, or a concert you went to, or a poem? Is it something in sports, like a record-breaking performance, like a hole-in-one shot, or a slam dunk, or a no-hitter thrown by a pitcher, or perhaps a perfect 300-bowler bowling game of a bowler? What is it that leaves you speechless? Furthermore, what is it that leaves you inspired? You see, I think we're becoming a society that's becoming increasingly more difficult to impress anymore. For example, I remember back in the 1960s when we sent the first rocket into space, the people that saw the rocket just disappear before their very eyes were left in awe. They were speechless. Today, no one even pays attention to our space program. When someone used to sing the national anthem, it used to bring tears to our eyes. Now, as soon as the last word is spoken, we sit down, we grab our soda, we change channel, get ready for the ball game to start. Today is hard to be inspired. It's hard to be speechless anymore. We've gotten so immune to things. But God is something that we should never get used to being speechless with. God is the one that we should always be inspired by, and one that should always leave us with truly nothing to say, because we're standing in front of Him and all in wonder and realizing how insignificant we really are if it wasn't for His grace and His mercy. Today I want to speak to you about what really is awesome. And I hope that it inspired you today. And the first thing that's really awesome is the person of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen. Hallelujah.
You know, I have been around some pretty amazing people. I'm surrounded in this room by amazing people. But I have never, ever seen any of us that are as amazing as Jesus.
Amen.
I have seen people do things that defy logic, but never has anyone done what Jesus did. Jesus was the ultimate record setter. He did things that no one ever imagined. Jesus Christ is awesome. Whenever somebody says to you, you know, ask you the question, how is Jesus? The word first out of your mouth should be awesome. Magnificent. If you're brave enough, say He is dynamite.
Amen. Sure is.
On the Isle of Patmos, the Apostle John got a glimpse of just how awesome the Lord is. In Revelation 1, verses 10 through 18, hear what John said. He goes, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Now, isn't that a great start to me? On the Lord's day, John said he was in the Spirit.
Yes.
That's a very good start to a phrase. And he said, I heard behind me a loud voice, yes, as of a trumpet. Another verse says, of a rushing water, saying, I am the Alpha and I am the Omega. I am the first and the last. He said, and what you see, I want you to write in a book, and I want you to send it to the seven churches which are in Asia. He said, to the church of Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. He said, then I turned, John said it, to see the voice that spoke with me. And having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. And in the midst of the seven lampstands were one like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to his feet, and girded about his chest with a golden band. He said his eyes and hair were like wool, white as wool, as white as snow, and his eyes like a flame of fire. His feet were like fine brass, as if refined in a furnace, and his voice at the sound of many waters. He had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp double-edged sword, and his countenance was like the sun shining in his strength. Get this. And when I, John, saw him, I fell at his feet as dead.
Amen.
But get this. But Jesus, he laid his hand on me and said to me, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. I have the keys of both Hades and of death. John said that when he turned and saw Jesus, face to face in all of his splendor and all of his wonders, he said, I, John, fell at his feet as dead. Means he fainted. Folks, we still serve that same Jesus.
Amen.
The same Jesus that holds the stars in his hand, that has the fiery eyes and the white wool hair, that when he speaks, it's like rushing waters. This should get our attention. What I found very interesting, though, that John said he heard all this once he was in the Spirit. How many of you know that sometimes the fleshly man can't understand the things of the Spirit? He said, I found it dead for him. Why? Because Jesus Christ is truly, truly awesome. He's awesome in many ways. He's awesome in his power. Colossians 1, 15 and 18 says that he, being Jesus, is the image of the invisible God. Says he is the firstborn over all creation, for by him, he said, all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. He says all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Folks, that is ultimate power in a nutshell. Everything was created by him and for his good pleasure. You and I are just along for the ride.
Amen.
Do you know that? Yeah. We're just along for the ride. He says he is the image of the invisible God. Anybody ever seen God face to face and lived yet? I doubt that. When you want to see what Jesus looks like, I mean, what God the Father looks like, his character, the way he looks at you, look at him in the person of Jesus Christ. He said, I am revealing the Father. Matter of fact, in another passage, he told the disciples, and the disciples had enough of all that. He said, show up the Father, it'll be enough of us. Jesus said, wait a minute now. Have I been with you so long you ain't figured this out yet? When you see me, you see the Father. Me and the Father are the same. You see, I'm here to tell you that Jesus Christ is not only the Son of God, but he is literally God himself. And he is so awesome and wants to do awesome things in our lives, but we have made him nothing more than a Philly cheesesteak sandwich. When we put a Philly cheesesteak sandwich in the same category we put God in, there's a problem there. A steak sandwich should be pretty good, but God should be awesome.
Amen.
He should be awesome. You see, Moses saw Jesus' awesomeness in the burning bush. Elijah recognized his awesomeness in that still, small voice.
Yes.
Joshua saw that awesomeness in a drawn sword. Isaiah saw that awesomeness in the temple as his train filled the temple. Peter, James, and John saw that awesomeness up on a mountainside. Paul saw that awesomeness on the road to Damascus. And you and I have been revealed to that awesomeness every time we look at the cross and see him on that cross, dying for each and every one of us. Shows you how awesome he is. You see, he is awesome, Jesus that is, and his ability to transform the human heart. Do you know that? If you ever think that you transform somebody, you've been deceived. None of us can transform anybody. That is only done by God himself, by Jesus. You see, even I read a documentary that one of Hitler's bodyguards, his name was a guy named Kurt Wagner. He adored Adolf Hitler. He revered him as a god even. And at the end of the war, when Adolf Hitler came to his end, Kurt Wagner, the thing said, was so shattered by Adolf Hitler's demise that he contemplated suicide. But he went for one final cup of coffee, and while he was drinking his coffee, he found his gospel tract there on the table. And at first he began to look at it and just passively read through it, but all of a sudden he got more interested in it. He began to read it more carefully. Later in that evening, it, 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 favored him so much that he sought out a local pastor of a church. And that local pastor, by God's doing, led him to the Lord that day. And he became a born-again Christian. One of Hitler's main men became a born-again Christian. Why? Because of the awesomeness of God. Because of the awesomeness of the transforming power of Jesus Christ. Folks, don't think he's not awesome. Don't think he can't save your loved ones. Don't think he can't change your situations, because he can. We just gotta believe him for it. So he's awesome. Another thing that's very awesome this morning is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is truly awesome. Do you know that the Holy Spirit is the part of the Trinity that gets dogged out the most? You got the Father, you got the Son, you got the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, folks, is with us right now.
Yes.
He was sent by the Father to be a gift from the Father, to empower us, to convict us, to educate us. But yet, we often ever talk about the Holy Spirit. He's awesome, folks. He's in our lives. If you see any of the guys and the girls on the stage doing a great job, thank the Holy Spirit for it. If this message moved you this morning, thank the Holy Spirit for it. The Holy Spirit is truly awesome. You see, he's awesome in his ability to be everywhere at the same time. How many of you moms feel like the Holy Spirit sometimes? I remember a preacher told me one day, he goes, yeah, the Holy Spirit speaks to me quite often and gets on my case. More times than not, the Holy Spirit is my wife. The Holy Spirit is so awesome that he can be everywhere at the same time. Aren't you glad that when you need God in your life, God don't say, well, I will send the Holy Ghost, but he's over there at Elliot's house right now. He'll be with you later. No, he's there at Elliot's house and your house because he's awesome. He's awesome in his ability and his power to convict the sinner. You know that before you can acknowledge you're a sinner, you have to be convicted of it?
Yes.
You know when people, they go to AA, alcohol abuse classes, the first thing is to get off the denial process. You got to admit that you're an alcoholic. It's the same thing. For you to get free from your sins, you got to acknowledge that you are a sinner.
Amen.
And he does that very well. He's awesome in his ability to cleanse the heart of a sinner. Do you know that only God can do that? You can have neurosurgeons and all these different kinds of surgeons. They go into your heart and they can do everything they can, but they can't take out that sin. Only God's Holy Spirit can do that. He's awesome in his ability to teach us the ways of Christ, but he goes a step further. He gives us some extra credit. He also don't teach us the ways of Christ. He reminds us of the teachings of Christ. You know, if we get older, we forget things. Or is it just me? You forget things. The other day, somebody said, when's your birthday? I said, when is my birthday? I forgot my birthday. My mother sends me a reminder on my phone every time somebody in my family has a birthday. Hey, you know, next week's your sister's birthday, or next week's your birthday, or next week is the president's birthday, or somebody's birthday, you know? The Holy Spirit reminds us of what Jesus' words say to us. Because a lot of us don't do enough Bible study on our own, so we have to have the Holy Spirit to remind us a lot, you know? He's also awesome in his power to guide and comfort us. I want you to hear something. There was this Jewish rabbi, and he from Tel Aviv, and he was sharing to his class his hatred for Jesus. How many of you know that Jews don't like Christians? That many Jews, not the Jews that have been converted, not Messianic Jews, but regular Jews, they think Jesus was nothing more than a brother that got off the way. He got deceived by us Gentiles. But this guy, this Jewish rabbi from Tel Aviv, he was sharing to his class his hatred for Jesus. It was so greatly his resentment that he sharply even criticized one of his students that was reading a Hebrew New Testament. Well, later on that night, he took the Testament away from the boy and he took it home with him. He meant to burn the New Testament. And he said that he stayed awake for a few minutes reading out of curiosity what this boy found so intriguing. And the rabbi went on to say in a testimony that after he read the New Testament, minutes became hours and hours became days. And after several days of reading the New Testament, he said that I have found more than 200 passages of Scripture in the New Testament that prove beyond a shadow of a doubt that Jesus is the Messiah.
Amen.
And he says, oh, the power of the Holy Spirit to bring to light what Satan kept me in darkness for. Hallelujah. That is awesome that the Holy Spirit can take a Jewish rabbi who's been in darkness and draw him into light of Jesus. You see, he is truly awesome, not only to teach, convict, and comfort, but also for his power. It says in Luke 24:49, behold, Jesus said, I send the promise of my Father upon you. He says, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with power on high. There used to be a commercial that said, American Express, don't leave home without it. I'm here to tell you folks, the Holy Spirit, don't leave home without it.
Amen.
He's got power.
Yes.
He's awesome. He can change situations around. Me and Crystal, just this last Sunday, Crystal stood right here. Was it Sunday or Wednesday, Crystal?
Wednesday.
But you were here Sunday, right? Wednesday.
Yeah.
She said, Pastor, I have to go back to my old job and I don't really want to go there. I want a new job. We prayed right here the prayer of faith together. And we said, God, we want you to intervene. And the Holy Spirit intervened, and she just got a new job this week.
Amen.
This week, she got a different job. A different job. The Holy Spirit is awesome, folks. He's here with us right now. You should thank him, David, for how awesome he is. Another thing that's awesome is the Word of God, the Bible. The Bible is truly awesome. Do you know that? Do you know that? Al Bogart, he showed us a great video the other night in the men's group. Great video. It was truly awesome video. He told me 15 minutes was an hour long, but that's, you have to do that, and let Patrick let you do things. But it was truly, truly awesome. You know our founding forefathers and those that really were the pillars of this nation, our earlier presidents and everything, they held that Bible so sacred. They founded the bedrock of this nation on the written Word of God. That's how awesome it was. And do you know that it still remains the best-selling book on the planet, the Bible? And the Bible has been around for over 10,000 years just so you and I can know the will of God for our lives?
Yes.
It's awesome. Do you know that the Bible is awesome in its indestructibility? It's been around for over 10,000 years. It is unified in its purpose. Get this. It's got 66 books of the Bible. They were written by 40 authors, which were two kings, two priests, a physician, two fishermen, two shepherds, a legalistic theologian, a statesman, a tax collector, a soldier, a scribe, a butler, and 25 others from equally diversified backgrounds, ranging from peasants to poets, statesmen to scholars. They wrote it in the wilderness, they wrote it in dungeons, exile, wartime, peaceful time, over a period of 1,600 years in several countries, on three continents, in several languages, on hundreds of controversial subjects, and yet the Bible still remains completely harmonized, scientifically, archaeologically, both past and present, perfectly together. Why? Because it's truly awesome. The Bible is truly awesome. It's truly awesome. I know some of you say it doesn't match up to Facebook. Yes, it does, folks. It's greater than Facebook. It's greater than Time Magazine. It's greater than Sports Illustrated. It's better than your famous romance novel some of you ladies like to look at. It is awesome. It is awesome. Why is something so awesome that we don't spend enough time in it? I don't know, but it's awesome. It has the ability to inspire holy living. Do you know that?
Yes.
It's awesome in the fact that it has prophetic fulfillment. It's awesome in that it is relevant for everyone's life, no matter what time you live in.
Amen.
Do you know that?
Yes.
The Bible is so awesome that if it's relevant back then, it is relevant today. Do you know that? It's not outdated. It's relevant. I want to share with you another little testimony. This came from a Hindu in Lahore, India. There were these Christian missionaries, and they wanted the verse Matthew 11:28, the one that says, come to me all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. They wanted that stamp on every single track they had. But they couldn't find anybody in the region of India who had that stamp, except for a Hindu stamp maker. So they went to the Hindu stamp maker and said, can you make this for us? He said, yeah, well, I can make it for you. And the testimony went that as the Hindu stamp maker began to make that rubber stamp, and he began to stamp all these hundreds of documents, he said that as he began to do that, the Word of God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, began to cut through his heart. And he said that while I was cutting this stamp for the missionary, God was cutting away at my heart. And because of the word before him, the word before him transformed him. And he became alive and a Christian. You see, Hebrews 4:12 says, "For the word of God is living and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing of soul, spirit, and of joint and marrow, and it is a discerner of the thoughts and intentions of the heart." You know what it says? The word of God cuts deep.
Yes.
Cuts real deep. You know, a lot of you got saved in a different way. Some of you got saved, gave your life to Jesus through a nice song or an event in your life or a testimony. I got saved by the word of God. I began to read the word of God and I said, "My word, I'm not doing any of this stuff. I'm not doing any of it. As a matter of fact, I'm doing a lot of the bad stuff here, but not any of the good stuff." And that day, I knelt down and I gave my heart to Jesus. Why? Because the word was alive. It was speaking to me. It was awesome to transform my heart. No different than he did the Hindu's heart, no different than he did the Jewish heart. He transformed his heathen's heart. I know he done it to yours too. The word of God is truly, truly awesome. Another thing that's awesome, and here's where we're going to really start to ruffle some feathers, is the church. The church, folks, is awesome. I remember in my last church I served at, the church was going through a bad season. And the pastor's wife got up to the podium. She said, "Listen, if you want your church to grow, when you come in contact with people at the Applebee's or the store or whatever, and they ask you how your church is doing, don't say it's doing terrible. They're never going to come. We've got to start thinking differently about our church, folks."
How did it think it?
Do you know what? Do you know that sometimes, you ever have, like your children, you raise your children, and your children, all day, you raise them since they were children, and you don't realize how much they've grown, but somebody who hasn't seen your children in a couple of years, they go, "Wow, look how big little Cindy's guy. Oh, wow." Do you know that the reason why some of us don't realize how awesome our church is here? It's because we're a little bit too close to the forest. You see, people who haven't been here for a long time, they come here and they go, "This place is awesome. My word." People will come here and say, the word, the messages are dynamic, the worship dynamic, the love of the people are dynamic, your ministries are great. We've had missionaries come here on Wednesday night and they go, "Man, look at all these people you have here. Oh my God." The last missionary said that. They go, "The last three churches we went to, and there were 15 people in the house on Wednesday night for 2 months. Big, beautiful churches. Every Wednesday we have 50, 60, 70 people here. Sunday mornings we got 110 or above every single Sunday morning. You know why? We have an awesome church.
Amen.
Do we have problems? Sure, everybody has problems. Yes. But we have an awesome church.
Yes.
Our church is awesome in the ability it has to bring hope to people.
Yes.
It's awesome in the ability it has to influence our society around us if we would just use that voice. It's awesome in its ability to survive attacks. How many of you have been under attack, but through your church praying and singing through it, you got over it?
Yeah.
I know I have. Our church is awesome in its diversity. You know there are some churches that if you're a certain color or a certain nationality, you're not allowed there?
Yeah.
But not here. You look around. You got all kinds of different color and nationalities and creeds and genders here. There's some church. I know one church. I don't even allow children there. Don't allow children. Well, I can tell you the truth. Don't allow children. They're a problem. Gotta get rid of them. The church is awesome. I want to look at the Eiffel Tower. The Eiffel Tower, it was built for an international exposition in the 19th century. Now, I want you to hear this. The structure was called monstrosis by the citizens of Paris at that time, who demanded it be torn down when this exposition was over with. Yet from the moment its architect first conceived it, he took such pride in it and loyally defended it from those who wished to destroy it. He knew it was destined for greatness. Today, it is one of the architectural wonders of the world, the Eiffel Tower, and stands as a primary landmark of Paris. In the same way, we are struck that Jesus, through his loyalty for the church, has kept the church intact despite all the people that want to tear it down, despite all those for centuries that want to get rid of the church. Jesus keeps the church intact. Why? Because he knows it has great purpose and great fact. Jesus, the architect of the church, knows that we are destined for greatness, the church. And I'm here to tell you that like the Eiffel Tower, this church right here has got better days ahead. It's going to be destined for greatness. Yes. It's going to be a landmark in this community. Amen. For those that come in.
Right.
Folks, we're going to be moving down the street. The Lord tarries long enough and he gives us his grace and mercy. And that church there is going to be opening up to all kinds of people that are going to come.
Amen.
The church is awesome. It's an awesome church here. It's an awesome church.
Amen.
He says in Matthew 16:18, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. He went on to say in 1 Peter 2:5, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Christ Jesus. You know what he's saying here?
Amen.
This building called the church occupies us, the believers, called the church.
Right.
We are great folks.
Yes.
The church is really you and I.
Yes.
We are the building blocks to it all. And guess what? We're awesome. The enemy would say you're not awesome, but you're awesome. You make the difference. You make the difference. You know what? My wife could testify to this. I am the Abraham of my family. I am the only pioneer Christian in my family. In the beginning, they used to always be against that. But guess what? Every time they have a catastrophe in the family, if someone needs prayer, if someone needs a funeral done, or a wedding done, or a blessing done, or some kind of counseling, they call Pastor Eddie up on the phone and say, oh, I need you. Why? Why? Because I'm part of the church. I'm part of something bigger than myself. And they know it. They know it. And the same thing for you and your families, in your lives, and your co-workers. They're going to come to you. Yeah, John, right now you got a little bit of opposition. Eventually he will come to you. He will see the godly man you are. And he will come to you for advice. We are the church. Be proud of being the church. Be proud of it. Don't let anybody take that away from you. But finally, I want to leave you with this one. Not only is Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, the Word of God, and the church awesome, but our mission is awesome. God has given us an awesome mission. Some of us have jobs that are not so fun. I saw a program that said the worst jobs in America. And then one guy, his job was cleaning out septic tanks all day long. Wasn't a very good job. Matter of fact, we had our tank cleaned out about 6 months ago. And I was talking to the guy, I said, man, do you like your job? He says, what do you think? He said, it pays good, but I don't like it. Some people have not been given a good job, a good mission to do. But guess what? We have.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ has given you and I an awesome job to do, an awesome mission to do. William Barclay gives us an excellent insight into the nature of the mission of the church. He says here, suppose a great doctor discovered a cure for cancer. He says, once that cure is found, it is there, the cure. But before it can be available for everyone, it must be taken out to the world. Doctors and surgeons must know about it and be trained to use it. The cure is there, but one person cannot take it out to all the world. A corporation of doctors must be an agent whereby which it arrives to the world that is suffering. That is precisely what the church and its mission is to Jesus Christ. It is in Jesus that all the people and all the nations can be reconciled to God. But before it can happen, they must know about Jesus Christ, and it is the task of the church to bring about that good news. Christ is the head, the church is the body. The head must have a body through which it can work. The church is to do Christ's work, the feet upon which it runs, and the errands on which it accomplishes his voice. We have a cure for the world, and that cure is Jesus.
Yes.
But we have to get it out there.
Amen.
We have to take that mission that he's given us and get it out there. That's why I said to you earlier that in Matthew 28, which is called the Great Commission, it's not called the Great Suggestion, folks. It's called the Great Commission. He says that all authority in earth has been given to me, Jesus says. What did he say? Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and look at this, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. for surely I will be with you always and to the very end of the age. We have a task to do, folks, a great task to do. It's not somebody else's task. I had a guy to work with that way. He would always have these suggestions for everybody else to do, you know? And you just say, you know, what's that saying that goes, don't put off tomorrow what you can do today? Yeah. That guy was, don't put off tomorrow what you can have somebody else do for you today. Jesus has not given this mission to anybody else. He's given it to the church. It is an awesome mission. It's awesome. You know, I wanna say to Rose and Brian here, guys are doing a great job. They bring a new person here every single week. They really do. I said, hey, who's this person? Well, this person is my neighbor. Who's this person? This person that we lived on the street. And John and Jennifer Bling have done that, and some of you have done that. They keep bringing new people all the time. Well, you might say, well, they're not always here. Doesn't matter. One plants a seed, one waters it, and God gives the increase. They're out there trying to win souls for Jesus. They're trying to, in their own Jerusalem, Samaria, and Judea, which is right here in Beverly Hills, they're trying to be that missionary for God. They're trying to fulfill that mission. We got the same opportunity, whether it be on our jobs or our next door neighbor. Some of you ladies walk on the trail, fantastic, walk the trail. You're looking great, you're feeling great. But if you see somebody walking the trail next to you that don't know Jesus, talk to them about Jesus. That's our job, that's our mission. It's an awesome mission. It says here in Romans 10, 13 and 15, Paul says, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Now that sounds good until you hear this. But how then will they call on him who they have not believed in? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have never heard of? And how are they to hear without someone preaching to them or telling them about it? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? And he went on to say, as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach good news. You see, it's one thing to say anybody who calls in the name of the Lord will be saved, but how can they call if no one ever told them?
That's right.
Folks, I'm so moved to tell you that when I first got the word given to me, I didn't receive it. She remembered a man named Lewis Bagley. We had worked in a shipping and receiving plant with him, and he, good old brother, man, and he was always happy at work. We were all miserable, he was happy. And he was telling me, man, I used to DJ in the ABC Liquor Lounge and do cocaine, and now I DJ for the Lord now. I'm high on Jesus. And I'm like, oh God. Well, every day he'd be talking to me about Jesus, every day. And that was back in my days where I was in my Def Leppard days. Remember that group, Def Leppard? I had the first Stonewall jeans, holes in my knees, and had long hair, and had the old feather earring, I won't say right, did with it. But anyway, did all that kind of stuff, and I was a bad dude. And every day he would come one way, I'd go the other, you know, that kind of deal. And sometimes he cornered me, and I had to hear it out of respect. Well, before I left, about 2-3 years in the process, I went to another job, and he said, listen, before you leave, I got something for you. He said, I want to give you this. And he gave me a Good News Bible. He says, God told me you're going to be using this one day. He said, because right now you've heard the news for 2 years and you're without excuse. I said, oh, man. So I took it, just to try to appease the guys, figure this will be the last time I see this guy. I'll never see him again. Well, my journey took me the way it took me, like your journey takes you the way it takes you. And down the road, I did come to know got to know Jesus. And Millie one day went to this church thing that she went to, and who was there? She heard the guy's name. He was doing something up there. Said, I'm Lewis Bagley. And she goes, Lewis Bagley? What if that's the guy? It looks like him. So she went to him, and she said, hey, do you know a guy named Eddie Padgett? Oh, yeah. She said, well, I'm married to him. You know, he got saved, man. He's a born-again believer. She said that Lewis went on to the holy dance. He was going crazy. He was celebrating Jesus. Why? Because he was obedient to God. He did his part of the mission. He left the results up to God. How many people that we talk to that we think rejected us and today may be saved someplace else? Think about that, folks. It's a great mission we have. It's an awesome mission we have, and we need to carry it out. Knowing that we are in the presence of awesomeness in Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, yes, the Word of God, the church, and the mission we have, shouldn't that compel us to be in awe of what we're about? Shouldn't that inspire us beyond ourselves to do greater things than we're doing right now? Being that we're standing in the midst of awesomeness, shouldn't we be inclined to be awesome as well? Shouldn't we be inclined to do things with excellence? You know what I'm going to say right now? I'm not going to get into specifics, but it's not even important. But I'm going to show you, I saw awesomeness in display before my very face, before this service started today. Two of my leaders broke the cardinal rule. They got into an altercation before service. That's a no-no. It kind of stifles the spirit. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
My board member and drummer, Stephen Dodge, and the First Lady got into an altercation. They went into my office like two Brahma bulls. They were going at it. I'm proud of both of them. They were both just shooting straight from the hip. Both of them were. With respect, but shooting straight from the hip. He spilled his guts out, she spilled hers. And I'm sitting there, my heart going, ka-boom, ka-boom, ka-boom. But as they're talking, this level became this level. Before you know it, two magnets going that way became magnets going this way. And they resolved their situation. And they hugged and embraced and loved each other and walked out better. Folks, that's what it's all about.
Yes.
That's what it's all about. That's why Millie was testifying against the spirit by the spirit earlier by saying if you have an awe against someone, settle that thing. Get it settled. Don't let it fester into something not supposed to be.
Amen.
Because we are an awesome church, a part of an awesome mission, serving an awesome God with a blueprint called the Word of God that's truly awesome. Why don't we work it out together? Work it out together. That's the God way of doing things. You know that? It is. It is. I was so proud of them too. Here I thought I was losing a wife and a drummer, and them two are best buds now. They're BFFs now. Can we stand today in God's house? Because you know what? A lot of us need to start doing that. If a lot of us can start doing that one to another, Pastor can put away his fire hat and stop putting out fires. If I can put away my fire hat, stop putting out fires, then maybe I can spend more time in prayer and fasting and reading the Word. That'd be nice. You know what? Say this with me. Jesus is awesome.
Jesus is awesome.
Holy Spirit is awesome.
Holy Spirit is awesome.
The Word of God is awesome.
The Word of God is awesome.
Our church is awesome.
Our church is awesome.
And our mission is awesome.
And our mission is awesome.
Don't forget that. He's awesome. He's awesome. He's awesome. We're going places, folks. We're going places in Jesus. Marriages that may be struggling, they're going places. They're coming back together.
Yes.
Finance that may be strained, it's going to get better. Things are going to get better. Some of you, like Joy, got an appending surgery coming up. It's going to be okay, sister. Well, no, appending means coming. Not appendix, I know that. I'm not giving you something to wonder about. Steve, God's not done with you yet either.
Amen.
You know, this is going to be all done. And then I have to play the golf game and get beat. What I'm saying here, God loves us. And there was a saying that said this. Oh, if God could be with us. How about we change it around and say, oh, if we could just be with God. Let's determine we leave here today to be with God.
Amen.
To understand how awesome He really is.
Amen.
And to understand how awesome the task that we have before us is. Father, in the name of Jesus, God, we thank You for this word today. We thank You, God, for this worship service, for the offerings we gave up, for the children we prayed for that are going to school tomorrow, for all the families that are represented, our regular attenders as well as our new visitors. We thank You for everyone. And we thank You, God, most and foremost for You, Jesus, who came from heaven to not only show us the Father, but to give His life as a ransom for all of us. God, we give You praise and thank You for that. We thank You, God, that You didn't leave us as orphans. You sent the Holy Spirit to be with us. And You gave us a direction book. And You brought us into one body called the church. so we can comfort and strengthen each other. But God, you placed before us a mission, one that you want us to fulfill before you come. God, give us the open door. Give us the opportunity for co-workers, family members, next-door neighbors. But God, give us favor with even those among our own brothers and sisters here in the church. Help us, God, to rise up. Rise up and be as awesome as you are, God. Right now, can you all raise your hands like this? Both hands up. I ask you to do this sometimes as a way of surrender. And I ask you to repeat after me. Dear Jesus, here I am. Awesome in the way you made me. Help me, Lord, to fulfill the awesome mission that you've called me to. Help me not to fear, but to be filled with faith as I leave this place today. Help me to stand in awe, inspired awe of the awesomeness of you. For I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Steve, can you come up here for a minute, and Millie? I'd like to have these two up here for a minute. If you need prayer for anything at all, please come up and let one of these two pray with you. You may be going through a real tough situation, and you hear how awesome God is, but you need His awesomeness to show up in your life right now. If you have to be dismissed, consider yourself dismissed with my blessings. But if you would like to come and get prayed for, please come and get prayed for. If you stay around and fellowship a little bit, try to keep it as low as you can for the reverence of these up here. God bless you in the name of the Lord. Greet each other out there, some of you.